Meeting of the Barnstable County Commissioners. Before I call this meeting to order, I will read the following notice. The meeting will be held through remote participation of the Board of Regional Commissioners pursuant to Massachusetts Governor Charles D. Baker's order suspending certain provisions of the open meeting law on March 12, 2020. All public comments or questions should be directed to Jack Units, County Administrator, at jackunits@barnstablecounty.org. The board will address any submissions at its next meeting. With that, I'll call the meeting to order, and we will now stand for the Pledge of Allegiance. Pledge allegiance.
To the flag.
To the flag.
To the flag.
United States of America.
States of America.
And to the republic.
To the republic.
Which stands.
For which it stands.
Under God.
Under God, indivisible.
Liberty and justice.
Liberty and justice for all.
Now, I'll have a moment of silence to honor our troops serving our country here and overseas. Thank you. There will be any public comment, as I said, will be directed to Jack Units at barnstablecounty.org. We now move on to the approval of minutes. We have minutes from October 14th.
I move to approve the minutes of the Board of Regional Commissioners' regular meeting of October 14, 2020.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Any further additions or corrections? Hearing none, I'll take a vote. Ms. Beatty?
Beatty, aye.
And Ms. Flynn?
Flynn, aye.
And Bergstrom, aye. And moving on to general business, we now have our weekly update on the COVID-19 in Barnstable County. Sean, you're on. You're muted, but you're on.
Good morning, all. Sorry about that. Thank you, Chairman Bergstrom. Again, for the record, my name is Sean O'Brien. I'm the director of the County Health Department. If it's okay with the chair, I will hand it over to Vera to go over our numbers, and then maybe we'll have a little bit of a discussion what we're seeing on and off Cape.
Okay, that's fine.
Good morning, all. Vera Harik, Barnstable County Department of Human Services Deputy Director. You've received the charts for this morning. Generally, we remain in single digits in terms of acquiring new cases per day. This is good. It's indicative of a very low to no evidence of community spread, which is very good. On occasion, we receive an increased case counts on a daily basis, which is indicative of serial testing or routine testing that's mandated by the Department of Public Health in congregate living facilities. And when cases are found, in the last month or so, they've been largely asymptomatic cases, people not exhibiting symptoms, but testing positive as a part of this routine testing. And again, from a surveillance point of view, it's good to have these indicators early so that the public health system and medical providers can intervene to prevent onward infection, both in facilities and in the community. Case counts in the hospital are extremely low at this time, which is excellent. We have one patient in hospital as of yesterday's report, no one in the ICU. We've acquired another three fatalities since last week. Over the last 2 weeks, we've had six fatalities. Our current fatality number is 181 persons. Regionally, Rhode Island remains problematic, and case counts there are increasing, as are cases in southeastern Massachusetts. And in one of the figures that I've emailed, I show the state's recent risk map for at-risk communities in Massachusetts, and many are red in the environs of Boston, and I observe cases, I'm calling it case creep southward, seemingly toward us, and also eastward from Rhode Island, potentially toward Cape Cod as well. Plymouth County has basically turned red, meaning that there are over eight cases per 100,000 persons daily average. on Cape Cod. None of our communities are near red, but we do have three in the yellow category, meaning between 4 and 8 cases per 100,000. If cases begin to increase here on Cape Cod, I would expect our most densely populated communities to show those numbers first, and that would be some combination of Falmouth, Barnstable, and Yarmouth. We are not seeing that yet, however. Thank you. I'll pause. I'll step aside for Sean.
Mr. Beatty, you have a question?
Yeah. So you're saying the Cape is not experiencing such an intense surge as the rest of the state?
That's correct.
Okay.
Yes. And I wouldn't call the rest of the state an intense surge per se. Some communities in the areas of Boston are seeing disproportionately high case counts. What we are seeing is a trend upward that is moving faster in some communities than others.
So my question is this, since we've had the precautionary measures like the social distancing and wearing a face mask, everybody's been hyper vigilant for the most part, what accounts for this increase?
I think it's the seasonal changes that we're seeing. People are returning indoors more, where infection is more easily takes place more easily, I couldn't speak to the others without delving in more deeply. I don't want to respond off the cuff, but I do feel that it is the seasonal changes that we've been expecting.
Yeah, we're going in. That makes sense. All right, thank you.
Yep. Certainly. Great.
And I think Vera described it well. We're not seeing numbers go up high, but they are raising. We're looking at, I think yesterday we saw 822 cases in the Commonwealth. So those numbers are starting to go up, and we're starting to see hospitalizations go up as well off Cape. And so right now for us, we're just really trying to just kind of see what's happening within the Commonwealth. Yes, we have seen some towns close to us fall into that red zone, so to speak. Plymouth. It seems like Nantucket is working its way out of it. They do have a stop the spread clinic that's over there. We're hoping to get some details on it over the week. But we see Plymouth and we see some other areas within southeastern Mass. Just looking through some of the data earlier in the week, we saw Sturdy Memorial Hospital, you know, just a little bit higher or a lot higher on hospitalizations. I think we were in the teens there. And here on the Cape, we're looking at maybe 2 or 3 people. And today we actually have 1. So, you know, it's just one of those times right now where surveillance is our friend. And we need to continue to look and conduct our surveillance, look at the numbers, look at what we're seeing across the region, and just, you know, and that's one thing that we're going to continue to do is working with Vera and discussions with the health agents is just make sure that we're all on the same page should we start to see any type of bump happen. So this is just kind of a key time for us just to kind of, you know, watch and discuss and constantly keep the information channels open.
Any more questions for Sean on that? I have a question. Sean, I've had preliminary discussions with Jack about potentially having in-person meetings of the commissioners at the East Wing. Mm-hmm. I haven't been able to share that with my fellow commissioners because of the open meeting law, but now that we have this meeting, it might be an opportunity to broach the subject. It seems to me that that facility, if there's any facility which is set up for having in-person meetings, would be the East Wing. Mm-hmm. Set up with screens. Anybody wishes to remotely participate can do so. We can maintain quite a distance between the three commissioners and Jack and so on, and limit the public to perhaps half a dozen or 10 people. So I'm throwing this out to you and to Mr. Beatty and Ms. Flynn and see what they think about this. Not right immediately. I don't anticipate having a meeting doing that the next meeting. We're, the question of we're going to have a meeting after the, immediately after the election, I'm going to try to avoid that if I can, which means we're going into November, November 11th, which is the earliest date we can do this. So I just wonder if any support or lack of from Mr. Beatty or Ms. Flynn or any of the members of the staff. What do you think, Sean?
I think if you let Vera and I kind of keep an eye on the numbers over the next couple of weeks, we might be able to give you a little bit more of an educated determination on that.
Okay. Well, like I say, we have some time and.
Yep, I appreciate that.
Okay.
I think that's a good plan.
I think. Am I? Yes. I'm not.
Yeah. Strategically, Mr. Chairman, I should add that IT. Is ready to set it up, and we can do it in the dual capacity, so that we're running it as we presently are, and people that want to appear online as opposed to in person can do so.
So my question is this: you're talking about two things, not having a meeting on November 4th, right. And which is fine, and also having an in-person meeting earlier than we had previously discussed.
I don't remember what we previously discussed, but I'm not setting a date for that meeting. I just want to see. I'm hoping potentially that we can commence in-person meetings at least either later in November or for the few meetings in December. But
that's fine with me as long as we do everything properly. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think I just want to point out that the 11th is actually Veterans Day, we'd either do it the 12th or the 18th, probably.
Right. So if we skip the meeting of the 4th, we're not going to be back until the 18th.
Or the 12th. We could do it on a Thursday, I suppose, if we give the public enough notice.
Okay.
We'll see.
We'll leave that up to the commissioners. You tell us what to do.
Mary Pat, are you happy with in-person meetings? You don't have to be there.
Yes, I am.
You are.
I really. Okay.
We want to see your smiling face.
Right.
This is smiling. Normally, I recognize Dave Murphy because I know he has another job besides sitting talking to us. So I'm going to recognize him, and he's going to give us an update on the effects or not effects of COVID on the registry. Dave, are you there?
Yep. Good morning, Dave Murphy, Registry of Deeds. I really don't have much of an update. We're pretty much where we were last week. Revenues are still strong. There's no indication on the ground here of anything really slowing down. Anecdotally, you know, I'm hearing things that, you know, we're going to see things start slowing down towards the end of the year. But again, with the election in November, you never know what's going to happen. But as of right now, our revenues for the month of October match what we took in all of October as of this morning. So we're way ahead. For October as we were for the first quarter. So things are strong here and no indications of slowing down just yet. That's about it if unless you guys have some questions.
Yeah, I have a question. Is this true? Is it increased throughout the Commonwealth, do you know, or is it just basically a big increase here on the Cape?
Well, that's a good question. And Register Meet is actually on a call with the other registers right now. We have a conflict every other week. There's a registers call on Wednesday, so he's on that right now. So I really don't have that data, but I would imagine that the suburbs and kind of the exurbs are probably a little stronger than the city right now, but I don't have any concrete data.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
All right. Have a great day.
Yes, thank you. All right. Moving on to B.
There's no motion for it, so I guess it's just, I was told that it actually, there's a question whether this even needed to be on the agenda.
Yeah.
It's related to C, which is, and there's some issues with C.
Jack, do you want to give us a quick, us and the public who's listening, a quick
These are two actions that came before the Municipal Town Council last week. I believe that Charlie checked off with Bob Troy on these. I had no idea they're actually even on their agenda. But it's similar to the discontinuance motion that we had several weeks ago regarding a road that was going to be used by the Capelin for the installation of the utility easement. And that's all I know. Bob Troy did okay it. That's why item C came before you today.
So I'm going to speak to this. The way it's on the agenda is parallel to where the petition they wrote, and then the motion that was given to me. We know what they want. They want the county to discontinue its interests in Craigville Beach Road. However, they only reference Chapter 82, which has 40 sections. And I quickly went and checked Chapter 82 and looked over all the sections. And I think the reason why they didn't put in a section is there is no section to legally do this. Their petition is defective. So I think we need more clarification so that we don't do something that doesn't actually exist in statute. It needs to be double-checked. That's what I'm saying.
I'll get back to Bob Troy.
Yeah, I mean, at minimum, when they sent this petition to us, they should have MGL Chapter 82 in reference to section. They didn't. And when I went and checked it myself, I'm no lawyer, but I do have some legal training. I saw no section specifically for this kind of action. Even though we did this before, I think we just took it for granted that they did everything properly, and it's kind of sloppy.
The last thing they did reference Chapter 82, Section 3.
Section 3?
Yeah, but you're right on this one. There was no specific reference. So let me check that.
Are we okay to put it off for a week?
Yeah, I don't think that's going to hurt anything.
So I don't see there be an issue with a week's delay on this. Maybe the attorney can get back from Barnstable, get back to us with more of it.
Yeah. I mean, there's certainly we have no problem because all of Chapter 82 basically is kind of archaic. It gives, I guess county commissioners at some point in the distant past had a lot of control over bridges and roads and streets and stuff. And it's all about that. And it's really not much of anything that we do, nowadays. But anyway, if we could postpone it, since I didn't make any motion on anything, I don't think we really have to do anything.
That's right.
Looking into
let me do a motion to postpone.
Yeah, why don't we do the motion to postpone?
I move to postpone agenda item 6C till whenever the chairman wants to address it.
6B and 6C?
6B and C, yeah.
I'll take a vote on it. Mr. Beatty?
Beatty, aye.
Lynn, aye.
And Bergstrom, aye. And moving, this is not the first time this has come up, and I know that this goes back to, like Mr. G says, when the county had over the roads. It seems to call for a legislative fix, at some point to correct that. This pops up, and next thing you know, we have interest in a road we had no idea.
We did it down at Provincetown one time. They wanted to end Route 6A or something in Provincetown, and it was a whole thing. The DOT was doing it, actually. But we had to sign off, and they had to do all the notices and so on. The other thing that, just so you know with this, is it looked like that once they petition us, they have to post it for 14 days. And it was dated, the 15th, so it hasn't been 14 days. So there's a couple things that are questionable about this. But anyway, I won't go on and on about it.
Why don't we move right along to D.
I move to authorize a letter of support to the United States Postal Service Citizen Stamp Advisory Committee for a Mercy Otis Warren commemorative stamp.
Second.
Seconded. I was at the ceremony for the current recipient, and there were several other former recipients there. They broached this subject. Apparently, there's a committee looking into stamps, a federal committee, and she is one of the nominees. So we're, of course, going to, and she's a very accomplished woman. If you go and you Google her, you'll see that she was a playwright and an author and a confidant of many of the original founders of the country, including the Adamses and the Hancocks and so on. So, Jack, do you have anything to add to this?
No, I think all I can add is, that we did put together that draft letter for your review, and if you're okay with it, you can execute it, and we can put it in as part of the portfolio.
I read, you know, I had the letter online. Unfortunately, I didn't copy it. If any of the commissioners have the letter in front of them, or Jack, if somebody want to read it, it's a short letter.
I think Owen's got it in front of him.
Owen?
Yeah, I read it this morning. I discussed it with Owen. I did have one minor suggestion on it, but just for, you know, so it'd read more smoothly. And that was the third paragraph, just changing it. You know, we kept repeating the word year and just say with each that there's an annual Mercy Otis Warren Woman of the Year Award. And, that, and you know, he knows about it. Just making that one minor alteration. But other than that, the letter looks fine.
Okay.
Thanks, Owen.
In that case, why don't we just go ahead and vote on this then?
Yeah.
Did you make the motion on that?
Yeah.
Lady? Yes.
Yeah. So we get a vote.
And move and second.
I would just comment on last year's recipient of this award. I certainly support it for the future. I think it's our history is so important to us, and this is part of our
history. All right. In that case, I'll take a vote on it. Beattie?
Beattie, aye.
Lynn?
Lynn, aye.
And Bergstrom, aye. Okay. We now have a discussion on and the reporting of fiscal year 2020 financial overview. I see our finance director is with us. Welcome.
Good Identify morning.
And give us your report.
Okay, Elizabeth Brosh, finance director, for the record. I'm going to share my screen, if that's okay with everyone, which is the copy of what you received in your packet. Can everybody see that?
I can see it, yeah.
Okay. So this is just a highlight of our fiscal year 20 year-end finances. Our revenue highlights, general fund revenues, specifically what I'm speaking to, the revenues came in $926,000 higher than the originally budgeted and estimated revenues. This compared to last year where we came in at 2.6, mostly because we lost ground in the last quarter. It was the registry that kind of kept us afloat. The registry revenues were the primary driver. They came in $1.02 million in excess of our budget amount compared to last year of $1.5 million over the estimated amount. The courthouse rental increase in rental reimbursements was $147,000 more than what we estimated. It's kind of a misnomer when we say rental. It's also reimbursements for all the work we do in supplies and overtime and expenses. We do a whole report to the Commonwealth. We come to an agreement. They do an audit of what we send them. And this was in excess of what we had estimated we would get. And then our investment income was $117,500 in excess of what we budgeted. When I went and looked to see what happened, because as we know, in March when COVID hit, the interest rates dropped, investments dropped. We actually had dropped $8,000 a month less than what we averaged for the rest of the year. So we did lose. We would have had more had we not had that drop in interest earnings. And then on the downside, the departmental revenue and fire academy revenues, because of the PFOS problems we had at the academy site, we had a deficit in those estimated revenues, but thankfully, you know, the other areas picked up, so we didn't have a deficit overall in revenues. The Fire Academy was budgeted in before we knew what that we weren't going to be able to run it, so we're hoping that we'll get those revenues back in at some point. Now, on the budget side, the general fund budget expenditures, we turned back $2.7 million of the overall budgets compared to 1.4 from that we did last year. We took measures immediately when COVID hit and reduced spending. We put a hiring freeze on. We wouldn't let, you know, we just said no unnecessary spending, just stuff to get by. So we had some things that we normally wouldn't have spent money on. We had to buy some laptops and things like that to get people remote. But then we saved in other areas, supplies, the ink cartridges, drinking water, lab supplies, travel, copier usage, utilities were the big hitters when it came to turning money back for fiscal year 20. I'm going to just pause if anybody has any questions, or you want me to just keep plugging through it?
I can wait till the end of your report.
Okay. And then this is just a highlight of the general fund unreserved fund balance. So we ended at $10.5 million for the year. The beginning balance was $13.6 million. We transferred in almost $1 million, $974,000. And when I say we transferred in, the county accountant and I went through our budgets, and not just our budgets, our general ledger, and just found some areas that money was just sitting there that we were able to close out to the general fund. And that's what equates to that number. There's detail on the other report that I sent you for that. And then the transfers out were some of the boats that we transferred from unreserved fund balance, including the large transfer for the capital deficit that's cleaned up now. And then the total revenues that we're closing out to the general fund unreserved was $20.6 million. And then the expenses and adjustments came up to $17.5 million. That leaves us an ending balance of $10 million. So even though we took money out during the year, we were able to turn back at least $3 million to replenish. And then this is just a snapshot of all the other funds that we have between, you know, Cape Cod Commission, dredge, septic loan, the capital projects. There's a small deficit there. That's a timing issue with when we borrow in September compared to when we close out in June. So there won't be, there may be a deficit each year as of June because of the timing when they did the short-term borrowing. I'm going to try to rectify that and switch that borrowing to June at some point so there won't be a deficit at year end. There's special use funds. That's just an insurance reimbursement account and a couple other things. All grants at $1.3 million. The OPEB trust, we were doing really well with some investments there. Again, that took a hit in March, April, May, and then finally in June it turned around. We had some negative returns, and it turned around. We had an overall year-end positive return on the OPEB, but had, you know, if we didn't have the COVID, we would be further ahead on that. Our original investment was $850,000. We're at $885,000 now. Reserve funds and then the special revenue funds. For a total of all other funds, fund balance is $25 million. So together with the general fund, we have $35 million in fund balance on the books at year end. And then just a quick fiscal year 21 look forward. We've experienced a surge in the real estate market, as Dave has talked about and we've been talking about all summer. It's a record high first quarter for registry. The forecasts are pointing that a slowdown in the market this winter. Again, like you said, we won't know until what happens in November. There's not a whole lot of inventory of houses for sale. But here's the good news. The first quarter revenues from the excise taxes and registry fees exceeded our quarter estimates by $2.3 million. If we hit the remaining monthly numbers of our estimates, we're going to have excess at the end of the year. If we don't, this maybe help cushion the blow if we do have a slowdown. So it's really good news that we had such a strong beginning of the year, because if we do have a slowdown for the rest of the year, it should be okay. But we'll monitor it and report to you guys regularly on it. And then just a quick view of what the registries look like over the years. If you look on the right-hand side, it shows this is the first quarter of revenues. You can see where we were for last year, 20. We're well above where we were in 20 each month. And then our estimate based on, you know, I have an estimate out for the year, and I have a rolling three-year average. That's what I'm estimating for the rest of the year. If we hit those numbers, we can actually have an excess of $3.5 million. Again, this is all estimated and time will tell. So that's what I have on that. Any questions?
Yes, we have any questions from my fellow commissioners?
No.
Elizabeth, what?
Yes, sir.
We have, what you're saying is after the transfers we made within the last couple of weeks, we made several transfers into stabilization funds. And so didn't we do that?
We did, but this is a snapshot on June 30th. So that's not taking for account of the transfers we have made. So I think the transfers we've made so far still leaves us over $10 million in the unreserved fund balance.
Yeah, that's what I'm looking at. At this point, yeah. That $10 million figure takes into account the transfers we put into stabilization.
Not for this year. This is just for June 30th. So if you were to back out what we've already voted for our transfers this year, we still have around $10 million, I believe.
A little confusing there because we made the transfers just last week, so this is a June 30th snapshot. So
yeah, I can bring those numbers to you where we are at the moment based on the current year transfers at the next meeting.
Yes, Mr. Beatty.
Yeah, Elizabeth, the in this column here under registry revenues and FY21, that can you explain that the 3.5 million again? Because I know you said that we had 2.3 million surplus, but then you were thinking if we have the average of the last 3 years, is that how we come up with the 3.5 million?
Yes, exactly.
Okay. All right, thank you.
So I've extrapolated out for the entire year based on what we've done in the last 3 years average.
All right, good. Thank you.
And if we hit those numbers, that will be.
Very good. Thank you.
You're welcome.
I know I've asked this question before, but when we show an excess at the end of the fiscal year, it simply goes into general fund. I mean, it doesn't require a transfer into another account and start over again the next year.
No, it just at the end of the year, all the excess closes out to the, hopefully there's an excess that closes out the unreserved fund balance. If there's a deficit, that reduces the unreserved fund balance. We've been fortunate for the past several years to increase the unreserved fund balance.
Okay,
so nothing needs to happen. It's an automatic accounting year-end closing process.
Well, obviously I've been around for a while, and there's been past practices when we ever put a money into a certain account, even into an unreserved fund balance, it was usually done by a vote. But it's not automatically me. That's fine.
Yeah, no, actually, any auditor will tell you never post anything to the unreserved fund balance. It happens automatically with a systematic closeout. I will say that part of that unreserved fund balance, those transfers to the stabilization, will move it out of the unreserved fund balance, but we'll put it into those stabilization reserves. So.
You also mentioned that you closed out a couple of accounts that you found odd accounts here and there. That was a big issue 6 or 7 years ago when your predecessor, Plus One, seemed to have a lot of these little accounts that confused everybody. So we pretty much cleaned everything up now.
Yeah, we're working on that. Each, like the first year, we cleaned up a bunch of them, and then we're still reviewing some additional ones that we're saying, okay, now we can close this out. A lot of it is you got to look back to see what the activity has been. You don't just arbitrarily close it out. You got to make sure that everything is copacetic to do that. So this screen that I just pulled up shows you that some of the accounts that we closed out because there are just these reserves sitting out there that haven't been touched for years, and they're just general fund money. So we closed them to the unreserved fund balance to get a clean slate.
Were they invested in income producing, in interest producing accounts? Or
no, they're just sitting on the books.
Yeah.
That's what the stabilization will do. Those will be invested, and the interest will stay with that. I mean, it's invested in that it's with all our other cash in the banks, gaining some interest. But, you know, when you have operating money, you have to be very careful. You keep it very liquid so your interest rate's not as good as can be, like with stabilization. We can invest it a little bit more higher interest earning accounts because it's not moving on a daily basis.
Okay, well, thank you. There's no questions from my fellow commissioners. That sounds like good news. And, hopefully it'll continue.
Thank you.
Okay, new business. I don't have anything new to present to the board, if any of my members do. Then we'll move on to commissioners' actions. Authorizing the approval of the Barnstable County legal holidays.
I move to approve the 2021 Barnstable County legal holidays.
Second.
Okay, this is probably a yearly authorization. No further comment. Take a vote. Ms. Beatty?
Beatty, aye.
Flynn, aye.
And Bergstrom, aye. Moving on, item B.
I move to approve Barnstable County's proposed 2020-2021 holiday work schedule.
Second.
Okay, we moved and seconded. We discussed this earlier. There's no further questions. I'll take a vote. Mr. Beatty?
Beatty, aye.
Flynn, aye.
And Bergstrom, aye. Okay, moving on to C, we've had a couple of corrections in the agenda, but I think, Mr. Beatty, you have the final motion in front of
you. Yeah, hold on a second. There was a question on one of these, I think. I think
we need to move to amend. I know Vera is still here. Vera?
I'm here, yes.
Which one had to be changed? Was it the one with Sue Keone's and Kathy Riconda?
That's correct. Susan Quinones is the primary, and Katie Riconda is the alternate.
Okay, so I'll just change that before I make the motion. Okay. Ready? Yep. I move to appoint the following representatives and alternates to the Barnstable County Health and Human Services Advisory Council. Kim Conkra, I guess is the primary. Kate Lena, L-E-N-A, Dan Gates, Erica A. Woods, Sean O'Brien, Raymond Yawks, Susan Nagel, Christina Dower, Carol Ann Procasini, Gail Wilson, Susie Hopman, Meg Payne, Lisa Bushy, Susan Keones, Kathy Riconda, and Katie Everson for terms through May 31, 2023.
Second.
They move and seconded so that the alternates didn't distinguish between the members and the alternates, but I have them in front of me according to the agenda. So we go move forward with the motion. We have the motion and seconded. Any comment on that, Vera? You have anything to say? Does that satisfy your needs?
Yes, thank you. Just the alternate for the Human Services Advisory Council is Katie Riconda, not Kathy, C-A-T-I-E. She's the alternate. Susan Quinones. Susan Quinones is the primary.
Gotcha.
All right. Well, next case, I'll take the vote. Mr. Beatty?
Beatty, aye.
Glenn? Mary Pat? We lost you, Mary Pat? All right. Well, I'll vote aye on that. Chair votes aye.
Okay, so passes. D, I move to authorize the filing of an application with the Massachusetts Department of Environmental Protection for state financial assistance for water pollution abatement projects.
Do I have a second on that?
You're probably going to have to do it.
Yeah, I'm going to have to second that then. I will second it. Okay. We have someone to speak to this?
Yeah, I can start it off, but I think Steve Tebow's on the line as well. This is the emergency loan application that we were in the process of preparing and filing with DEP. It was a lengthy process, but what it's all about is essentially removing the two burn buildings that remain at the site, transporting them out of state to be disposed of, and then capping the site. I think the loan application is for 1.7, but Steve, you can correct me on that and take it from there.
Steve? Yeah, good morning. Steve Tebow, Assistant County Administrator. Jack's correct. We're going to be removing both burn buildings, capping the site to mediate some of the PFAS contamination that's on the site. We did some testing into the burn buildings themselves. They did test positive for PFAS within the concrete. So that makes it a disposal of out of state. There's no in-state disposal sites available for PFAS at this time. So we applied for emergency funding through the SRF funding process, and we just needed a formal vote from you folks. You guys gave us the approval originally to go ahead and go after the funding, but now we just need a formalization of that act for part of the process with the loan. So that's what's before you folks today.
Ian, are you with us? Have you contacted Mary Pat? Ian?
Yeah, I'm trying to get her back.
Okay. The question I have is, does the Department of Environmental Protection have a pot of money and they accept applications with no time frame? And
so there's two things going on, Mr. Chair. The part of it, they have a yearly application.
Good.
They have a yearly application process. This particular one is under the emergency fund. So they have an emergency fund that you can go in kind of out of date and out of time. So this is the one that we're actually going for now. And it's truly deemed an emergency just because of the requirements that we are under by DEP to cap the site. So this is the emergency part of it. And then there's a bigger kind of more formal process that we're also in the queue for further projects that we see coming at the academy.
Okay. Mr. Beatty, you have a question on that?
Yeah, I remember when we had the discussion on this. Was this for approximately $1.5
million? I think the total application was $1.7 just because of the current climate with construction and everything else. But the original ask in front of you was $1.5 that we had originally talked to with a solid number. But the limits within the permit was we decided to bring it up to $1.7 just in case. Ask for more and take less was the thought process of me and Jack.
So this application is for $1.7 million, or this is just a portion of that?
Correct. The total application is for $1.7 million, but the estimates that we're getting is somewhere between $1.3 and $1.5 to do the actual work.
Okay.
But it's one of those ones, sorry to cut you off, Mr. Chair, it's just one of those ones that in today's climate with the construction kind of boom that's going on, to actually pick a solid number, I wanted to request for more money than we actually needed because the out-of-state transport and the out-of-state disposal is kind of no one really knows who's going to take the product yet. So we kind of had to go two different, we have a pretty good idea of who's going to take it and we can, do a general cost estimate of what it's going to be, but there's no confirmed site yet on who's going to take the disposal of the material. So that's why we just decided to go for the more money of it. Hopefully with due diligence, we'll be able to come in a lot less than what we're anticipating.
Steve, is there a time frame for this? Is there a turnaround time frame for this? What are we anticipating as far as hearing back from DEP?
We're hoping to hear back in the next 30 days. And then go in front of, we're in front of ComCom again the beginning of November to get their final approval. And then, we'll go work with Jennifer and procurement and get this process going. So hopefully we can get a good portion of it done, in the month of December. And then the capping process probably not till March now just due to weather. But it all depends on when the asphalt plants close down for the season, if they close down at all this year. In years past, we always judged that they closed right around Christmas time, that they stopped producing asphalt. But in the last two or three years, they haven't closed them at all. So it's really going to be dependent on that if we can get the work done throughout the winter.
So you're saying you could hear back from DEP with an approval of this application within 30 days?
Yes, sir. That's part of the emergency process. And then the other more formal one, we wouldn't hear back until, I believe it's July.
Well, one would presume that if we're given the emergency, so if these are, is this for the same projects? So if we get the approval for the emergency project.
The emergency project is solely for the capping and removal of the two buildings on site. And then there's a bigger process that will be coming in front of you for within the next couple. It's a couple year process, but we want to get in the queue. So we applied for the funding already, and you can kind of get, it's going to be a longer and more stretched out process, but we're going to have to at some point address the pond that's at the academy. And then we're going to actually capture some of the more water that's out there. So it's going to be a longer, more stretched out process. So the emergency funding is for this year. And then the other funding that we're going for is going to be within the next couple of years, couple to 3 years.
All right. Well, we can find out, but we have that motion on the floor. Moved and seconded. We have both.
Beatty, aye.
Glenn, aye.
And Bergstrom, aye.
Thank you.
Thank you. E, I move to authorize the execution of an application for a grant from the United States Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration through the Massachusetts Department of Health Bureau of Substance Addiction Services, any amount of $125,000 to prevent substance misuse as part of the Massachusetts Collaborative for Action, Leadership and Learning 3 Mass Calls Initiative, for a period from July 1, 2021 through June
30,
2022. Second. Moved and seconded to applying for a grant for $125,000.
So I've got a question. Wait a minute. Yeah, it seems like this is like way out there. So it commences next July. That's unusual. All right, thank you.
All right, the question I have is, does this require matching funds if we receive the grant? Can I have someone tell me?
This is Vera Harik, Deputy Director of Barnstable County Department of Human Services.
Yeah.
To speak to this? The answer is no, it does not require matching funds. The what this item is, it's your approval for us to apply for right. This funding, which if our application is successful, will commence July 1 of 2021. And this is a continuation of our substance use prevention work in our department. The present funding under both the SAPSE and MOPSE grants will sunset in June of 2021. And so this would be for onward funding through Bureau of Substance Addiction Services to continue the work. And BSAS, which is the acronym for that bureau, has teed up this application opportunity, and it's a statewide opportunity. So as to continue the substance use prevention work that communities have undertaken already.
Yeah, I have a question. Vera.
Yes.
Forgive me if I'm confusing these two things. Is this the program or is that the tobacco control program where they run sometimes run radio ads and things like that?
This is in fact that okay. Program. Under some of the existing funding, we have for the last 3 years at least run a major public information effort on opioid-related okay. and substance use-related prevention.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, you're welcome.
Okay, we have a motion on the floor. It's been seconded. We'll call for a vote. Mr. Beatty?
Beatty, aye.
Flynn, aye.
And Bergstrom, aye. Okay, moving along to F.
Yeah, I move to authorize the execution of an agreement with the Town of Bourne to do and perform all dredge-related work for Little Bay for an amount up to a maximum of $371,800.
Been moved and seconded. Ken, are you with us?
I got questions.
Sure. Yeah, Mr. Chair, I'd like Ken's here with us today because this got a little complicated. The contract's going to be fine, and we'll ask you to execute it to approve the execution of it today. But Ken should really bring you all up to date on what's going on here because it's a little different. Ken?
Yes. Good morning, Ken Cirillo, the County Dredge Administrator. I received a call on Monday morning from the town and their consultant that they ran into a problem with having the site contractors. They had put a calls out for bids to 8 different companies and only had received one bid back. So they were asking us what we could do to help accommodate their problem, their challenge, rescheduling, et cetera. So we talked amongst ourselves. First, we offered one of our guys who had come from another company doing dredge work to help them, you know, sort of just trying to see what we could do to accommodate them. And then we reconvened and we looked again at some of the options. I spoke to Carl in Yarmouth to see what his availability was for the areas there, because there were some concerns about us switching and moving to Yarmouth with moorings, et cetera, being still in the water. So we had a call again yesterday, talked to them, we all voiced some of our concerns, some of our ideas, very good collaborative effort. And we strongly suggested that they take us up on the option, because Carl had agreed that we could go down to Yarmouth and begin both the Parker River and the whole Bass River project. So I just received the message from the town that they have decided to take us up on the offer to do the rescheduling. So what we will do now is, as soon as we finish probably 10 to 15 days more work at Sampson Island, we'll move to Yarmouth and do Parker River first, and then work and do the entrance and the approach channel up the Bass River, which will then tie us in to be able to get back to Dearborn the first week of December. So giving them enough time to put the bid out in the street with an RFP and hopefully, be able to do it the right way and not having to kind of kludge everything together with our guy and their guys and renting equipment and all the rest of the things that they didn't want to do. But, they were trying to see what they could do on their end as well. So even though we have this agreement in place, obviously get it approved, great. Our plan, our schedule right now is for us to do as I just laid out, Yarmouth first, and then head to Bourne. So we're very pleased with this, because it is the best outcome for everybody.
Mr. Beatty has a question. And you're muted, Ron. You're muted.
Sorry about that. I actually was somewhat privy to this, because I had to speak to a group of people up in Bourne on Monday night, and I asked for an update. What exactly is it they had to put out to bid? Some sort of ditch or something has to be dug on the beach, and then I'm not sure if it has something to do with the spoils afterwards after we dredge it out or what.
Yeah, exactly. Most of these jobs, and this one in particular, is a rather complex drainage basin, because of the volume of dredge material that we're going to be pumping. It's just not a hole in the ground. It's a real pit. With drainage, and it really needs to be done right. There's a pretty significant liability concern here as well. So that's part of the process, is digging the pit and engineering it properly. The effluent, the dredge material goes into the pit properly done. It drains, the water rolls down, goes back in rather clear. The sand is then excavated out of that pit and put, in this case, down the parking lot where they plan to store it. And then they're going to go ahead and move with the town of Sandwich, move the sand down, most of the sand to Sandwich, some of it to Monument Beach. So it's a rather complex job, but, from our perspective, the pit is an important part of it, managing that pit and moving the sand out of it. So it's not just a matter of moving and grading. It's a lot more to it, and that's the part of it that needs to be done.
Okay. And that doesn't impact the permits or anything like that?
No, all their permitting is in place for doing that. We did have some questions, and again with Foth, because they're coming up on the agenda item next. But with their help, Christine's help, because there were some challenges that we questioned about the design of the pit, because it's a very large job, it's a very large pit, and there's a lot of pressures and a lot of mechanical things that can take place. So they took that to heart as well, to kind of make sure to have that certified that it will stand up to the sand and the pressures.
And this is over by Head of the Bay Road section of it's on the other side of the.
Yeah, Little Bay. There's a little bridge that goes across, and then the Monument Beach area. Monument Beach is where the pit will be.
Okay, very good. Thank you.
You're welcome. Yeah.
And one of the problems we ran into in the past was very similar to this, is that we would set out our dredge schedule and then we would arrive or plan to arrive at a location, only to find out that the town itself had not, gotten the required permission and required permits. And I was hoping that we would have, track that more carefully so that we wouldn't run into this situation. What was the problem with Bourne? They just did. Were you not aware that they weren't, that they hadn't done this? Or,
yeah. Well, when I had contacted them last week, because we had had an agreement that we would meet with them, have a site visit with them to see the location, see everything that was going on. And, you know, when they didn't call me back midweek last week, I did sort of raise that flag. And then Monday morning they contacted us. So, yeah, I mean, to be honest with you, yeah, sure. It's another lesson learned. You know, is the permit in place? Yeah, great. Are the contractors in place? All of these things, the boxes that need to be checked. You know, those are their responsibilities, but obviously from our side, I can clearly see how, you know, you need to start running shotgun on these types of the projects as well. You know, not to babysit it, but, you know, it needs to be done because our schedule obviously is so dependent, and we're very fortunate that we are able to move and switch out with Yarmouth, and you know, timing works quite well. But if we were, you know, we could not have afforded to have a big pause button here and wait. So you're right. It needs to be tighter.
Mr. Beatty.
Yeah. So, and you can clarify this because it was kind of not real clear. This is the first time we've actually done dredging for Bourne, and at least in recent memory. To your knowledge, is that true? So maybe we just haven't been working with them because we haven't done dredging for them. And
yeah, I think this, Steve, you're on the call. I think we were scheduled to do it last year, and this got pushed back as well.
They never made the schedule last year because of the concerns of the permitting. They weren't identified with all the permitting in it. And then we met with them back in March to lay out what the program would look like before we put them on the schedule this year. And they assured us that they'd have a contractor in place to do the beach work. Part of their issue was they had a couple of retirements within DPW that used to handle the pits for them in years past when the dredge had gone there. So then they had to kind of go out to a subcontractor to get it done. And I think they, not to deform, but I think Boyd didn't anticipate the numbers that it actually cost to actually run the pit for a contractor to come in. So it changed the procurement end of it in order to try to get a contractor in there.
Okay. So my question is, have we dredged for Bourne before, to your knowledge?
Yes, we have.
We have.
About every 3 years, we've done different projects for Bourne, 3 to 4 years. This particular site has not been dredged in well over 50 years. We have not done this particular site before.
Okay, thank you.
Yep.
Okay, well, it sounds like you guys quickly, you know, made some adjustments to try to keep up the schedule. So thanks for that. And we're back in business. I don't remember. Did we take a motion on this? I think Jack interrupted us. We didn't take a motion on this. So Jack, are we prepared to go forward on this, Jack? And
yes.
No, I think, didn't I?
Yeah, you did take a motion.
I did make a motion. Yeah.
Yeah.
All right. In that case, we have a motion and a second. I'll call for a vote. Mr. Beatty.
Beatty, aye.
Glenn, aye.
And Bergstrom, aye. Okay. Bar.
So, G, it looks like the staff wants us to postpone this.
Yeah, we had talked about this at the last meeting. Is there what is the holdup here?
So, good morning, Phil Burt, Barnstable County. So, just I think that this got on the agenda a week early. That's all. So, this is supposed to go. This ordinance is going before the assembly to approve the actual funding this afternoon's meeting. So. Before any bid award can be made, it has to go before them. So I'll be presenting it same way we did to you folks a couple weeks ago to them this afternoon, and then move forward.
Yes, thank you. We will not move item G.
Thank you.
So we'll go to H.
We'll go to H.
Okay, H. I move to authorize the execution of a contract with Forth Infrastructure and Environment LLC in the amount of $92,950 to perform hydrographic surveying services for the 2020-2021 dredging season for a period through June 30, 2021.
Do I have second. A second? Moved and seconded. This is something that we authorized the bid or authorized yeah. going out to bid, and now we are approving the contract. Is that where you?
That's exactly right, Mr. Chairman. You approved the bid award a couple of weeks ago, and Jennifer went back and met with Forth and negotiated the final contract.
right. Okay. Moved and seconded. I'll call for a vote. Mr. Beatty?
Beatty, aye.
Ms. Flynn?
Flynn, aye.
And Bergstrom, aye. Okay.
Aye. Mortgage. I move to authorize the discharge of a mortgage by Amy Dodge to Barnstable County, acting by and through the Cape Cod Commission, dated March 7, 2008, and recorded with the Barnstable County Registry of Deeds in Book 22732, page 303.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. I'll call for a vote. Mr. Beatty?
Beatty, aye.
Flynn, aye.
And Bergstrom, aye. Okay, do we have septic betterments, Owen?
We do. It indicates on the motions that we don't, but some came in the last minute. So it would be great if we could make a motion just to authorize their execution.
Okay. I move to authorize the execution of certificates for dissolving septic betterments.
Second.
Moved and seconded. I'll call for a vote. Mr. Beatty?
Beatty, aye.
Flynn?
Flynn, aye.
And Bergstrom, aye. Okay, I don't have anything to report. I already touched on the Mercy Otis Award. Other than that, Mr. Beatty or Ms. Flynn have anything? No? Okay, we'll move on to county administrator and staff reports.
I think you've already heard from Ken. He mentioned dredge update and Steve on the fire academy. So I'll keep it real short and mention two things. One, Maggie Downey was gracious enough to supply us with a residential by electricity rates, which shows a 10 to 12% increase this year from last year, month to month. So we get a feel now for the increased population on Cape Cod. It's kind of settled in, and that trend is continuing. Unfortunately, the same graph shows that commercial is down about the same, and that's a heartbreak for us all, but that's the reality we're dealing with. And the second thing I just want to mention is Sonia did a great job putting up the registration information for the Cape Cod Climate Change Collaborative's workshop, which is used to be called the Net Zero Workshop, Friday morning, 9 to 3. Anybody can join. It's free. It's open to the public, limited to 500. But you can register online via our website. So,
Jack, are you talking about the Net Zero Conference?
Yes.
This is Friday. Is it Saturday?
Friday, 9 to 3.
Right. That's what I thought.
Okay. And that's all I got. Thank you.
Okay. Nothing from the staff? Phil, you have your hand up, but I don't know if that's just left over. Okay. It's gone.
No, down.
All right. So I guess there's nothing left but item 11.
I move to adjourn.
Second.
Okay, moved and seconded. Call for a vote. Mr. Beatty?
Beatty, aye.
Flynn, aye.
And Bergstrom, aye. Okay, thank you very much for participating. And
thank you.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.